Today we begin a new sermon series on the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah. Let's pray as we begin. Lord God, as we read the book of Jeremiah, help us to receive Jeremiah's words as your word written for us. In Jesus' name, amen. The first verse of the book introduces us to Jeremiah, son of Hilkiah, one of the priests of Anathoth in the territory of Benjamin. Anathoth is a little village 5 kilometres northeast of Jerusalem. We are reading the words of the son of a village priest from an obscure town. It is not a promising start, but Jeremiah would play a role of international significance. Do you ever think that you are too small and insignificant to serve God's purposes? Think again. After all, God chose to make the birth of a baby in the little town of Bethlehem the turning point in the history of the whole world. When did Jeremiah serve as a prophet? Verses 2 and 3 tell us about his moment in history. Jeremiah's ministry extended across 4 decades, from 627 BC in the 13th year of the reforming King Josiah, and through the reigns of the arrogant and oppressive King Jehoiakim and the weak and vacillating King Zedekiah, until 587 BC, when the people of Jerusalem went into exile in Babylon. Josiah was the standout king in Judah, while Jehoiakim and Zedekiah were among the many who did evil in the eyes of the Lord. Other kings also reigned briefly in Judah during this period, but these three sum up the trajectory of what was a period of national decline, defeat, and destruction. Why is this prophet from thousands of years ago of interest to us today? We are reading the words of Jeremiah, of course, because his words have been recorded and preserved for us and become part of the Bible, the Christian scriptures. Did you know that, in terms of words and verses, Jeremiah is the longest book in the Bible? In our 7-week series, we're going to pick out some key passages, but my challenge to you is to read the whole book. It only takes about 4 hours to read the book aloud, and if you read 1 chapter a day and 2 on Sundays, that will get you through the book of Jeremiah over the next 7 weeks. From the man, the moment, and the manuscript, we turn now to the ministry of Jeremiah. We are going to reflect on 3 points. First, the call of God in the life of Jeremiah. The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Before I formed you in the womb, I knew you. Before you were born, I set you apart. I appointed you as a prophet to the nations." 4 verbs in verse 5 emphasize God's initiative. I formed you. I knew you. I set you apart. I appointed you. And I did all this, God says to Jeremiah, before you were born. Isn't it reassuring to know that in his plans for the world and for your life, God is never caught unawares? We are often caught out by unforeseen circumstances, aren't we? Of course we are, because we don't know or control the future. God does. So he doesn't have to convene a heavenly COVID cabinet or grant the archangels emergency powers. He never says, "Oops," or "I didn't see that coming." Instead, God says through Isaiah, "I make known the end from the beginning, from ancient times what is still to come. I say my purpose will stand, and I will do all that I please." In a giddy world, that's very steadying, isn't it? Now, The fact that God called Jeremiah before the prophet was born shows that Jeremiah's appointment as a prophet to the nations is not based on his innate giftedness or impressive past performance or demonstrated future potential or thorough preparation, but on God's sovereign, gracious initiative. In light of God's sovereign, gracious initiative, there is no reason for panic and there is no room for pride. So how does Jeremiah respond? He says, "That's all well and good, Lord, but unfortunately I'm too young." He was perhaps still a teenager at the time. "Alas, sovereign Lord," I said, "I do not know how to speak. I am too young." But the Lord said to me, "Do not say I am too young. You must go to everyone I send you to and say whatever I command you." Being too young or too old, too ignorant or too weak or too anything else is beside the point. This call comes from the sovereign Lord. Gordon McConville writes, "It puts all natural and acquired qualifications in the shade. It also puts other aspirations in the shade. When God calls you, whether to salvation or to service, the effectiveness of that call does not depend on your capacity, but on the God who calls you, because he is able. There is no reason for panic, and there is no room for pride." We have not received Jeremiah's specific call to be a prophet to the nations. Paul writes in Ephesians 1, however, that God chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. And the words of Psalm 139 are true of each one of us. "Your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be." Christians, isn't it breathtaking to think that God knew you and chose you before you were born? As it is in our lives, God's call in the life of Jeremiah was an act of God's sovereign, gracious initiative. What would his appointment as a prophet to the nations entail? That takes us to our second point, the word of God in the words of Jeremiah. "Then the Lord reached out his hand and touched my mouth and said to me, 'I have put my words in your mouth.'" The first verse of the book tells us that we are reading the words of Jeremiah. Then we read that the word of the Lord came to Jeremiah. Now God says to Jeremiah, "I have put my words in your mouth." Jeremiah will be God's mouthpiece. When he speaks, God's voice will be heard. The words of his prophetic ministry will be God's words. And as we read his book, we read both the words of Jeremiah and the word of God. The language of word and words is prominent in Jeremiah, and it points to a wider truth. All of Scripture bears this dual authorship, human and divine, and the nature of the Bible shows us how we should read it. To quote John Stott, "Because Scripture is the word of God, we should read it as we read no other book, on our knees, humbly, reverently, prayerfully, looking to the Holy Spirit for illumination. But because Scripture is also the words of human beings, we should read it as we read every other book, using our minds, thinking, pondering, and reflecting, and paying close attention to its literary, historical, cultural, and linguistic characteristics. This combination of humble reverence and critical reflection is not only not impossible, it is indispensable." So what is God's message through Jeremiah. The word of God in the words of Jeremiah is a word of judgment and hope. See, today I appoint you over nations and kingdoms to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow, to build and to plant. The verbs tell the story again. The accent falls on judgment, to uproot and tear down, to destroy and overthrow. But through and beyond judgment, there is also hope, to build and to plant. God gives Jeremiah two visions to confirm this prophetic ministry. The word of the Lord came to me. What do you see, Jeremiah? I see the branch of an almond tree, I replied. The Lord said to me, you have seen correctly, for I am watching to see that my word is fulfilled. To understand this first vision, you need to know that the words in Hebrew for almond tree and watching sound almost the same. Every time Jeremiah sees an almond tree, he is to remember that God's word through him will be fulfilled. The second vision confirms the foreboding emphasis on judgment and foreshadows the coming Babylonian invasion. The word of the Lord came to me again. What do you see? I see a pot that is boiling, I answered. It is tilting towards us from the north. The Lord said to me, from the north, disaster will be poured out on all who live in the land. I am about to summon all the peoples of the northern kingdoms, declares the Lord. Their kings will come and set up their thrones in the entrance of the gates of Jerusalem. They will come against all her surrounding walls and against all the towns of Judah. I will pronounce my judgments on my people because of their wickedness in forsaking me, in burning incense to other gods, and in worshipping what their hands have made. As we read through the book, we will see that Jeremiah's long ministry passed through several stages. First, he called the people of Judah to repent of their sins so that they might not suffer God's judgment at the hands of Babylon. Later, he announced that God would indeed punish Judah. The time for repentance was past, and God's judgment was now inevitable. Then he announced that God's purpose in judgment was restoration. For those who accepted God's punishment, the Babylonian exile would be a way to life, and there would be a future beyond exile. That's a little foretaste of our series. What is our message as Christians? The word of God we are called to speak to the nations, the gospel of Jesus Christ, is also a word of judgment and hope. In the gospel, however, the accent falls on hope, because for those who trust in Jesus, judgment lies in the past, on the cross, where Jesus died for our sins. Nevertheless, in the gospel, God also warns of final judgment and calls all people everywhere to repent. It is written, "For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead." For Jeremiah to announce God's inevitable judgment on a people who refused to repent was an unpopular, painful, tear-soaked ministry. Outwardly, he was deprived of normal social and family life. His own life was repeatedly threatened, and he suffered imprisonments, beatings, and forced migration. Inwardly, he agonized. In the early chapters of the book, we see him wrestle with his calling and with God. Jeremiah is often called the weeping prophet, And as you read, it is sometimes hard to tell if the tears are his or God's. What could sustain Jeremiah in such a costly calling? For that, we turn to our final point, the promise of God in the ministry of Jeremiah. Do you know what the most frequent command in the Bible is? Do not be afraid. God says it to Jeremiah twice in this opening chapter, and with the command comes a promise. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. Get yourself ready. Stand up and say to them whatever I command you. Do not be terrified by them, or I will terrify you before them. Today I have made you a fortified city, an iron pillar and a bronze wall to stand against the whole land, against the kings of Judah, its officials, its priests, and the people of the land. They will fight against you, but will not overcome you. For I am with you and will rescue you, declares the Lord. Though Jeremiah's calling will be terrifying at times, God tells him not to be terrified. Why not? Because God will enable him to stand against the whole land. Because God is with him and will rescue him. Let's be clear. This does not mean that God will keep Jeremiah from suffering and death. We read about his painful sufferings in the book, and tradition tells us that he was ultimately stoned to death by his exasperated countrymen in Egypt. It does mean that God will give Jeremiah the life and strength to do everything God has called him to do. What about us? What can sustain us in the costly calling of following Jesus and being his witnesses? That calling is becoming more costly in Australian culture. Did you know that this year's Australian Christian Book of the Year is called Being the Bad Guys: How to Live for Jesus in a World That Says You Shouldn't? In Victoria, two new pieces of legislation put Christians in the position of being the bad guys. There is the law already passed banning gay conversion therapy, whose language is so broad that it could make it illegal, for example, simply to pray for someone struggling with same-sex attraction at their request. Then there is the proposed legislation that would make it illegal for religious schools to hire and fire teachers based on their conformity to the school's religious convictions. The promises of God's sustaining grace, his presence, and his rescue are ours in the New Testament. At his incarnation, Jesus was declared Emmanuel, God with us. At the end of his earthly ministry, when he commissioned his first followers, sending them out as his witnesses into a hostile world, Jesus said, "Surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." In the face of persecutions and pandemics and personal sufferings, God promises to sustain us, to be with us, and to rescue us. And because through his death and resurrection, Jesus has rescued us from sin and death, the end of the age is only the beginning. The promise, "I am with you and will rescue you," finds its ultimate fulfillment in the new creation. In the vision of the new creation at the end of the Bible, a loud voice declares, "Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will be with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that as you knew Jeremiah and set him apart before he was born, so you chose us in Christ before the foundation of the world. Thank you that we have your word in the words of Jeremiah and in the words of all the human authors of Scripture. Help us to read and understand the Bible, to believe its gospel message, to put it into practice in our lives, and to declare it with our lips. Thank you that you promise to sustain us, to be with us, and to rescue us. Give us strength and courage to live for Jesus in a world that says we shouldn't. In his name, amen.